Dean of the School of Humanities, and I'm very proud to have worked with. There's nothing more significant in the university, in my view, than the establishment of an endowed chair, which implies the commitment of the institution to a particular field of study in perpetuity. And this will not go away. This will be forever a distinct, important part of the university study. We are thrilled in particular to welcome Dr. Houri Berberian and the community to make this endowment possible. I'd like in particular to extend our sincerest gratitude to Vahe and Armine Meghrouni and the entire Meghrouni family joining us here this evening and from whom we will hear shortly as well. Also, in addition, the many donors who made the vision of an endowed chair in Armenian Studies at UCI a reality, of which there are many to mention. They are on the back of your program, a list, and many of those are also on the name of our celebratory plaque in honor of this. So this has really been an incredible community effort, and we thank you from the bottom of our hearts for your generosity. We have a terrific program this afternoon to celebrate this official installation, and that's the technical term we use in the university when you've established an endowed chair and you run an international search to find the best candidate, you select one, and then the formal ceremony to install the chairholder, and usually with some remarks, which we will have soon. While I'm here, I'd like to say a few words about the School of Humanities, which is one of 13 schools in the University of California, Irvine. We are actually the largest school at UC Irvine in terms of the number of faculty, the second largest in terms of our enrollments. So we are a very healthy central part of this university campus. We have almost 2,000 undergraduate majors in humanities and some 300 graduate students. And contrary to much of the media attention out there, our graduates are extraordinarily qualified and successful. In fact, we were rated the top fifth university in the United States in terms of the salary potential of humanities graduates. And I would say it's a very significant number because fifth in the country, well, the first four are Harvard, Colgate, Princeton, so places where if you're going there, you probably already come from a pretty good fortune and can do pretty well. Whereas at UC Irvine, over half of our students are first generation students to come to college, many from lower income or disadvantaged backgrounds, and the fact that we're able to be an economic engine of support for these students is one of the things I'm most proud of being at this university. In terms of our graduate programs, you may hear about unemployment of PhDs, but in our case, over 40% of our graduate PhDs get a tenure-track academic job within 3 years of completion, which is a number I would hold against any other institution. It's amazing. 80% get full-time academic employment, and many others choose to do other things, work in media, publications, and the rest. So, we are a young university, barely 50 years old, but I think we have built ourselves a tremendous track record and an innovative one that is resonant with the county in which we live. I would say at the present time, the development of Armenian studies actually takes place within a broader context of serious development and investment in a variety of cultures and peoples of the Middle and Near East. We have an endowed chair in Jewish studies as well, and a growing program there, as well as three endowed chairs and growing programs in a major research center in Persian-Iranian studies. We just launched this year a new global Middle East studies undergraduate program, which is doing amazingly well. And so this is an area of the world that we are bringing here. It's also, and we are cognizant that this is not just a study of a far away place, but that many of our own community have connections to those cultures and places. And so it is always a way to also be as local as it is to be global. So at this time, I would like to invite one of the people I most respect and enjoy, and that is Sivi Chetakian, who is the founding community leader of Armenian Studies. And I'd like to ask her to say a few words about the program. I've known her for 4 years now, since I came here as dean, and I've always been struck, really, by your tenacity and passion for the Armenian community. I think she knows almost everyone from Fresno to here, and is willing to embrace new supporters, and we thank you so much for all the connections you've made possible, including the many events you've held, even in your own home, and the tenacity and commitment and vision that you have brought to this. And so I would like you to come and say a few words in honor of you.
Thank you, Dean George, for the very kind words. Hello, everyone. This is my teleprompter. I want to take a minute and take you back to the year 2006, when I was introduced to Professor Turaj Daryei. And for about a year, we kept on meeting each other over brainstorming as to how to start Armenian studies. And since then, we have become partners in crime. I can't even describe my feelings for Professor Daryei. He has been the academic pillar and support system with his excellent direction and excellent enthusiasm for Armenian studies. In 2007, already in December, we had a fundraising in our home. It was a modest one, but enough to make sure that we could afford to offer one course in Armenian studies. Now, you can talk about a vision, but I never had a vision of seeing a chair established today, after 10 years. So one course led to two courses a year, etc. And then every year we kept on holding these fundraisings in our home. And one day, a few years later, the Meghrounis were attending our fundraising and they were already attending the public lectures at the university, and they were enthused by what they saw: high academic lecturers visiting the university and offering the best lectures that we could have ever dreamt of having, again thanks to Professor Vahe. I want to thank Vahe and Armine Meghrouni for their generosity. And you have to understand, I didn't go to them, I didn't ask for the funds, I didn't ask for them to do what they did. They came to us and they decided to offer the majority of the funds towards the establishment of the chair. I want to thank you, Vahe and Armine, and your lovely daughters who have been supporting you all this time. So thanks for the memory. One day, I received a phone call from Professor Arav Karyan, and he said, of UCI, he said, Sylvie, I understand you're doing fundraisings in your home. I said, yes. He said, why don't you ever invite me? And I said, Arav, it's a fundraising. And he said, never mind, I would like to be invited. To make the story short, he came up with a very generous donation, and I'm not quoting numbers here. Thank you, Ara and Alice, for your generous donation. Now, none of this would have ever have happened if we didn't have the involvement of the Armenian community. They attended the lectures. They were happy with what they saw. They were convinced that we should have the program go forward. And since then, we have had a lot of support from the community, from small donations to large donations. And I also want to thank every one of you here in the room and not in the room who have been serving on our committee to make sure that the program or the project would go forward. I also want to thank the Dean's Office, definitely, because they came up with a major idea for us, and they said if you raise a certain amount, we'll be happy to come up with a certain amount. And we said, great, and that was like a fuse, right, Dean? And we made it. We made it. So I want to give the Dean and the development ladies a big hand. 10 years to make sure that we all cooperate, and believe it or not, it has been a smooth sailing. We are very lucky today to have Professor Houri Berberian, who is a dynamic, encouraging, how shall I put it, Houri? An outstanding professor, of course. Thank you, Houri. I'm sure that she will be addressing some of the issues that she's thinking about, but I'm sure that she will have a wish list. So I'm going to suggest that we listen to her carefully and we follow her instructions on that wish list, because today is the culmination of the inauguration of the chair. It's not the end. A chair needs constant funding, and I want to make sure that we are all here to support Houri and the Dean, Professor Vahe, and the students, of course. So for next year, we have already planned two events. One in March at Zobs. I don't know if anyone in this room doesn't know where Zobs is. So Zob and Gavis Kalmadian have graciously offered to host a lovely reception for us. And the next reception will be at Alice and Arab Kalyan Song for our traditional December get-together for fundraising. Actually, Arab stole that tradition from us, but I forgive them. It's okay. With every experience I have had in my life, I try to walk away with a lesson. And this journey has been a great journey. I can say painless. And for me, when people come to you as a fundraiser and ask you what they can do for the project, that's the biggest victory for the fundraiser. Thank you all.
My name is Alexis Meghrouni Rivas, and I'm honored to be here today with my family, especially my parents, Vahe and Armine Meghrouni. We are here today to celebrate their gift to UCI, the Meghrouni Family Presidential Chair in Armenian Studies. My parents' decision to endow the chair underscores how much they value education and lifelong learning. And I know I speak for my sisters, Andrea, Michelle, and Sarah here in the audience, as well as myself, when I say how grateful we are to have parents with the foresight to support a university program such as this. We are so touched by their generosity. They have dedicated themselves to ensuring that our Armenian legacy is one that is preserved, respected, and understood, not just for Armenians, but for scholars of all backgrounds. We, as the next generation, applaud and encourage this endeavor, and are committed to seeing it develop and thrive. We have been impressed with the lecture series and eagerly anticipate the leadership and contribution of Dr. Berberian as she assumes her role at UCI. Last year, I heard a certain professor of Armenian studies speak of the 17th century merchant Markara Avagis, suggesting that he might have been selected as the most interesting man in the world. Well, that intrepid gentleman, Dr. Aslanian described, had nothing to do and no way to meet what my dad had to offer. Rather than recount his biography, I thought I'd take this opportunity to tell you some things you might not otherwise hear today. My father was born in Detroit a handful of years after his brother Victor, and then the Meghrouni family moved to Southern California when my father was in high school. He was an athlete as well as a scholar, and he played football into his college years. Vahe and Armine met while completing their medical training in Los Angeles. After serving in the Army Air Corps, my father attended USC, training in radiology, and during that time he met my mother, then training in anesthesia. Their marriage of 60 years became a true partnership as they pursued careers, raised their four daughters, and became grandparents to Zakios, Nolan, and Melinette. Their shared interests and values have strengthened their relationship and served as guideposts for their actions. Our parents were always interested in learning about different cultures and trying new things, traveling to many different countries, exploring, and being renewed in the outdoors, teaching us by example to be interested in and respectful of the world around us. The Vahe I know is ever inquisitive, always learning as his curiosity and brilliant mind lead him to investigate new things. While many of us have thrown up our hands in the face of a challenge, his patient and persistent approach has allowed him to understand and master the issues before him. One of my father's many interests that didn't get much of his time until the last several years is fine woodworking. And the examples of his creativity and skill are in my parents' home. I could not be more proud of my parents and what they have done for UCI and all of us. So with a heart swelling with love, I would like to introduce my father, Vahe Meghrouni.
What a fantastic turnout. We are so humbled and honored that You're all here today for this most auspicious event, for the wonderful installation that's going to occur, as Dr. Houri Berberian will be the chair of Armenian Studies, a groundbreaking occasion, and we look forward to decades of success in this endeavor. And judging by the fact that you've all taken the time to be here, and which is the most ultimate necessity for all of you to be involved and interested in the project of Armenian Studies here, with your attention, I think that it'll be a great success. I was asked to speak here in the past, well, I'm jumping ahead a little bit, but my main purpose here is to just describe it to the best I can as to why we are involved in the establishment of Armenian Studies. Before that, I want to make a few remarks and address Vice Chancellor Brian Hervey and to Dean of Humanities, George Van Der Beel, to the executive team of Nicole Balsamo and Ariana Lucusens, to faculty and to staff, to Professor of Persian Studies, Darye, Professor Turaj Darye, who nurtured and shepherded this program for 9 years, and above all, to the grassroots community who originated it. We give our sincere thanks for bringing the vision of our Armenian Studies program into reality. The Meghrouni family is happy for this historic day. We celebrate Dr. Houri Berberian, the chair of Armenian Studies. Her heavy charge is to complete the foundation of Armenian Studies and build a curriculum that spawns generations of students of caliber. What comes of it will be our mutual legacy. With endowment, the university wished to have an event for us, the Meghrouni family. We declined because this is not about us. It is about you, the community. Rather, we wish to serve and celebrate as part of a community. We hope it, the community, takes on the Armenian Studies as its own and expands it to become a major academic discipline. My following remarks are personal, and only to say with inadequate words the why of it all for our family. Why? 1,000 years ago, Omar Khayyam said, "The moving finger writes, and having writ, moves on, nor all thy piety nor wit shall lure it back to cancel half a line, nor all thy tears wash out a word of it." It is by no accident why we're here today. When I was 7 years old, I climbed the crown of the Statue of Liberty. She never spoke until she was 17. But ever since, she has been speaking ceaselessly. I never heard her until many years after we met. "Give me your tired, your poor, the huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shores. We are of the wretched refuse upon whom the lamp of Liberty's Lady shone. But we are not from teeming shores, as Emma Lazarus described. We are the refuse of a horrible, savage, mass extermination of the Armenian nation at the hands of the Turks, Turks who still today would blot out the memory, blot out the guilty and the their guilt and their memory, just as they would blot out a nation by genocide. While enduring the memory of the horror of that genocide, our parents sought sustenance in a new land. They barely recovered, only to find themselves in the Great Depression of the 30s, and then World War II. Precious little opportunity remained for them to nurture our identity. Yet they certainly did. Identity is the core of our being. Identity expands from the self to family, to group, to nation, and to country. And with such a strong identity, with such a strength, the identity serves all of these. The self serves all of these identities. A strong identity is a proud identity when it is strong enough to stand alone. Pride over others is a weak identity, as is false pride for a weak ego. An assault on one's identity is never to be tolerated. The following lines, modified from the poem Invictus by William Henley, fit an Armenian identity, a strong identity. In the fell clutch of circumstance, I have not winced nor cried aloud. Under the bludgeoning of chance, my head is bloody, but unbowed. I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul. Like Armenians relegated to obscurity for centuries, we, in our formative years, were anonymous as Armenian Americans. Now, in our lifetime, spanning almost all the 100 years since the genocide, Armenians are winning the battle to preserve our identity. They are winning because it is a battle that is now on a level playing field. It is in the hallowed halls of knowledge, the universities, where mankind seeks the highest order of truth, and that truth is our shield. Armine and I are children of survivors. We, with our first breath, became Americans, but our blood is Armenian. We vowed that the year 2015, the centennial year of the Armenian genocide, shall not, will not, and never come to pass without an endowed chair of Armenian studies in this prestigious institution, the University of California, Irvine. 3,000 years ago, the moving finger wrote, "They are here." Who are they? The Armenians, of course. It is no accident why we are here today. We come into this world naked, and naked when we leave it, but we are clothed in life by the humanities. Armenians are not strangers in the pursuit of knowledge because they revere learning. In the Great Migration of 1880 to 1920, the Armenians had the highest rate of literacy of all immigrants. Amongst them were my mother, Virginia Kalandayan, my father, Armen Meghrouni, Armine's mother, Zavat Diradurian, and her father, Zakios Khachadurian. There were 8 siblings in the Diradurian family. Zavart and her sister Paylun were left behind in Agan when the family was uprooted by genocide, the genocide. They were subjected to be brides for their Turkish neighbors and remained there until American Protestant missionaries came looking for them. A brother who had immigrated to America asked the missionaries to look for them. Though the Turks denied the sisters were there, the missionaries prevailed, and Sephard and Paylun came to live here with her brother's family in New Jersey, and there they met their future husbands. Zakios, Armine's father, born in 1895, was 15 years old when his parents sent him away alone and forever. Better that than the Turkish army. The time of several years elapsed. He worked in a tannery in England and then as a busboy on a freighter. During World War I, he jumped ship in Baltimore. It is said that ship was torpedoed after it left the United States. Zacchaeus was concerned when in World War II alias was registered, he thought he was illegal. However, an attorney unearthed records that Zacchaeus' father had come to the United States, become a citizen, and returned to Malatya. So Zacchaeus, after all, was a citizen. Zacchaeus' younger brother, Benjamin, was found as an orphan in the course of the genocide. Uncle Benny, who lived with his brother and sister-in-law, developed as a kind of Renaissance man. He instilled Armenian spirit in Armine, her brother, and cousins, and taught them to read and write Armenian, and exemplified himself what you might call the humanities. He left their household when he joined the U.S. Armed Forces in World War II as an older enlistee. By the time Virginia Calendarian was 13, the genocide engulfed her and her mother. They endured a travail that was long and arduous. Eventually, Bedouins fell upon them. The Bedouins murdered her mother, enslaved her, my mother, and graffitied her face with tattoos, blue tattoos, on her chin, to her lower lip, and to her forehead. Eventually, at great risk, she escaped and made her way to Aleppo. There she worked as a nurse at a Turkish military hospital. The war ended in 1918. As she had been betrothed at an early age to my father, she was resolute in making contact with him and emigrated to America to marry him at age 18. She spoke four languages and no English. She faced the public that often asked or thought, "What are those marks on your face?" In the fell clutch of circumstance, as quoted earlier, she did not wince nor cry aloud, for she was the master of her fate. In Detroit, always pursuing education and enlightenment, she earned an eighth grade certificate and a high school diploma. Without stopping, she continued on with adult education classes. She was self-taught in typing, wrote essays, wrote her memoir, and became an expert seamstress. Oh, and by the way, when the country was immersed in the Depression, she raised two sons while carrying the burden of trauma from the genocide. What's more, for a time during World War II, she was one of the women who had the sobriquet Rosie the Riveter. You've heard of Rosie the Riveter, because they worked in the war factories in the place of men. In California, later in life, she was widowed, but self-supporting by running a small grocery store alone. She was determined to be her own person. She bought a car and learned to drive independently in what might call the telephone and U.S. mail age. She made by herself all arrangements for a trip to Europe going on a freighter. She visited a long-lost related family and toured abroad by dint of her own curiosity and resolve. By 1964, 40 martyrs for Rayon High School, the first Armenian school here, was being initiated. At a time long past, she and my father had been acquainted with Rayon when he was alive. As an early supporter, she donated $5,000, 1964, of her own hard-earned money to that cause. The Marines say, "Semper Fi." My mother always said, "Never say can't." With others, my dad, Armin, was a talker. He never talked much about himself. There are long gaps in his personal history, as in so many family scenarios, one asks, why didn't we ask more of his story? He excelled in school with high marks. He was good in numbers. Before immigrating, he was working in a so-called counting house. "Why did you come here, Daddy?" "I was a Tashna, and I was keeping bombs under my bed. It was dangerous." He immigrated in 1910. I believe the timing of his leaving must have been influenced by the 1909 Adana massacre of 30,000 souls. The Constantinople massacres of 250,000 in 1896 were when he was a child, And parenthetically, although I didn't have, was going to mention it, he had, I think, was a stepbrother. I think he had a stepmother and a stepbrother who he said was worked as a policeman in Constantinople. That he was injured during those massacres. So my dad had firsthand knowledge about those massacres as well. Before he, my father, came here, he changed his family surname from Balyan to Meghrouni. He did not want a name with Turkish origins, as was common. Bal meant honey, so he translated it in Armenian to Meghr, and added a uni with a double meaning, in that it is grammatically a possessive case, and also an ancient Armenian ending. He came alone at age 19, fluent in four languages, including English. I never heard him speak with an accent. He served in the American Army during World War I with the rank of sergeant, which incidentally was two ranks above my time in World War II. He graduated law school at Marquette University and passed the bar in 1922. My father never made much money because he never charged Armenians, and his clients were all Armenian. I spent a summer in New York City when I was 7 because my dad was an attorney on the defense team for the trial of 9 Armenians accused in the murder of Archbishop Levon Turyan. And that story is one for Armenian Studies. There is a footnote. My dad was born in the little village of Munjusun in 1891. In 1895, Asadur Sarafian, nominally a cousin, I suppose everybody was a cousin back there, was born there. Asadur arrived in Milwaukee, a teenager, where my dad and his brothers were. Asadur translated his name to Oscar Banker, Sarafian meaning banker. He went to a technical school and obtained a job with a printing press company. From then on, he became a renowned inventor with 91 patents, 27 are a major consequence. To mention three, number one, in 1927, the first working automatic shift for cars and buses. They run the 1934 buses of Chicago. Number two, in 1943, a gear system used in a Sikorsky helicopter, military helicopters, vital for it to fly. That was his invention. In 1968, he invented a needleless repeating inoculator for immunization used by the armed forces. When our government asked to buy rights for the helicopter gear system, it would have been a huge untold amount. Oscar said he would not charge his country, he would give it to his country because it was what he could do for his country. The story of Asadur Sarafian, aka Oscar Banker, is but a vignette of the mark of Armenians in this world, on this world. Armenians must not be known just as hapless victims. Commemoration of the Armenian genocide stands separately and supremely as sacred and unassailable. However, it should not overshadow Armenians as a people worthy of recognition and respect. Without Armenians, the quality and essence of mankind would only be so much the less. Armenians have always been a relevant, dynamic people. For the United States alone, in a compendium titled, Yes We Have, by Stepan Vartamian, the likes of Oscar Banker, our entries are chronicled along with over 700 entries of other persons and patents for the United States alone. Before finishing, I have a word here for two who are here in spirit. Dear Rav, it is done. Sireli Mairi Yathairi, here up. I should like to conclude with verses from a song I learned long ago as a child. I am the builder who walks with me. The glory of souls upraised shall see, and the towers that rise to the arch of the skies. For I am a builder, the builder, who walks with me. You see, I, we walk with thee.
You, Vahe, your wisdom and generosity are a constant inspiration, and one that I think will continue to motivate our program here for years to come. Thank you so much. And at this point, it is my task to welcome my colleague, Professor Touraj Daryeh, who is the Masse Chair in Persian Studies and Culture and currently Director of the Jordan Center for Persian Studies and Culture. I'd like to make a few remarks. It is due to his leadership, together with Subi Tsatakian's support, that the Armenian Studies program began in 2007. So we're coming close to the 10th anniversary, which will be another occasion. And he'll share some additional insight on the history of Armenian studies at UCI and also introduce the Meghrouni Family Presidential Chair in Armenian Studies. Please, Touraj.
Thank you, Brother Abi. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I was going to say a few words about at least my recollection on how this Armenian chair took shape and so on, but Sylvia, you basically said all that I was going to say, and I'm happy after a decade, thanks to many people in the community, as well as Vahe and Armenia, and of course you yourself from 10 years ago, that we're able to have Professor Berberian here with us at UCI. So, having said that, let me introduce Professor Berberian in another way. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my distinct pleasure to briefly outline Professor Houri Berberian's academic work and the trajectory of her intellectual development. Having been born in Beirut, Lebanon, to an Armenian parents, Professor Berberian has been part of a history that she has been studying. We at the History Department at the University of California, Irvine, are not only interested in the specifics of the research of our faculty, but we ask that they look further afield and see the region, and at times the globe, to make better sense of the issues and developments in history. Professor Berberian is an ideal candidate for our History Department, as she has taken upon herself to look at the Armenians outside the traditional boundaries of nationalism and to look at the role of Armenians throughout the Middle East and the Caucasus. This knowledge of the Middle East and the Caucasus developed during her studies at UC Berkeley and UCLA, both of our sister institutions. This is also an important point, as she is well aware of our student body here at UCI and is knowledgeable of the California educational system, having taught for many years at Long Beach State University and as the director of the Minister Studies Program. Professor Berberian has worked in graduate school with two of the giants in the field of the Middle East and Armenian history, Professor Nikki Keddy and Professor Richard Hovhannissian. Hence, her training in both specific to Armenia, but also regional in nature, is actually quite significant and important for us. In her first book, Armenians and the Iranian Constitutional Revolution of 1905-1911, The Love for Freedom Has No Fatherland, Professor Berberian explored the military and the ideological contributions of the Armenians to the Iranian Constitutional Revolution of 1905-1911. Until this book, historians had largely neglected Armenian participation in constitutional revolutions. The book makes new contributions to the subject in several ways, going beyond the more common narrative of heroic exploits of individual Armenians. Based largely on the archival of the dominant political party of the period, the book provides an analytical study of how and why Armenians of different political persuasions participated in the Iranian Revolution and the connections between the Caucasian and the Iranian-Armenian political developments and the community. In the discussions on the 19th century developments in the Armenian community, Professor Berberian spent some time on the new politicization and educational developments that transform a significant segment of the population as new secular schools for boys and girls, partly created with the aid of newly found women's organizations, educated a greater number of Armenians. This movement led her to think about women's activism and role in education, not only among Armenians in Iran, but also among other minority women in the Middle East, a subject which she pursued in a work entitled Armenian Women in the Turn of the Century, Education and Activism, which was awarded the Association of Middle East Studies Women's Prize for Excellence. In continuation to her study of gender, Professor Berberian was invited to contribute to several venues, including the Encyclopedia of Women and Islamic Cultures on Armenian Women and Women in Armenian Religion, which looked at Armenian women in the Ottoman Empire. And by focusing on women's shared experiences with each other and the Muslim majority as well, as exploring historical and regional variations when discussing women in Armenian religious doctrines and practices, and Armenian women's lives within the larger Muslim community. Another work of her on equivocal sole rulers, the lives of New Julfan Armenian women and early modern laws, seeks to uncover the world of Julfan women unfathomed by European travelers and yet unexplored by scholarship, through an analysis of Armenian laws governing women's status and gender relations, and of documents like wills, petitions, and powers of attorney produced by women, and these are all stored in public record offices in London, where she, as she looked at the Archivo di Stato in Venice and Florence, which I want to go to, and the All Saviors Cathedral in Jaffa. Her forthcoming book, which is coming out soon with the University of California Press, is a reflection of her intellectual trajectory and the development of research interests that have consistently expanded by considering the global context of history of the Armenians. And that is very important. The book is entitled Roving Armenian Revolutionaries, Itinerant Ideas and Connected Revolutions Across the Russian, Ottoman, and Iranian Frontiers, explores the interconnectivity of the Russian 1905, the Ottoman 1908, the Iranian 1905-11 revolutions in several ways that interweaves global, regional, and local. The study advocates a novel approach that draws on connected histories to illuminate the way in which the revolutions are connected and transformed through their connection. And she gave a wonderful talk in this regard, when she was invited, when I had some say in world historians' rising interest in tracking individuals across borders as a way of writing global, transnational, and connected histories makes this especially timely, as it speaks to the larger concerns of world history movements, and may in some modest way inspire similar studies in other revolutionary periods like the 18th and the 19th centuries. The story Professor Berberian tells in this book is a story of connected revolutions, a story of peoples and ideas in upheaval, and in collaboration with each other. A story of revolution as a concept, and revolutions on the ground, and the promise they held for the imperial subjects, and a story that spans three empires and foregrounds historical processes, and actors brought to light with novel conceptual approach to historical writing informed by world history and connected history. With such a strong record, I think, in world history, Middle East history, gender history, and specifically Armenian history, it is wonderful to welcome her as the Meghrouni Family Presidential Chair in Armenian Studies to this year. Thank you. For Armenian Studies at UCI, and because we are actually short for time, she will have her lecture and then we will go directly to the reception, which is preferred. So please.
So I don't know if any one of you noticed on your way to the parking lot, there were two signs. One said Armenian Studies Chair Installation, and right underneath it, it said the future of crime in California. I can guarantee you there is no relation whatsoever between the two. Thank you, Taraj, for that generous introduction, and thank you all for being here to share this very exciting moment for Armenian Studies and for UC Irvine's history and the history of the Orange County Armenian-American community. I am both humbled and honored to hold the first Meghrouni Family Presidential Chair in Armenian Studies and to join UCI's highly regarded Department of History. It is a particular pleasure to be here at UCI because I myself am a product, as Taraj pointed out, of California's public university system, having received my BA in Berkeley, at UC Berkeley, and my MA and PhD at UCLA, and having almost all of my teaching experience at California State University, Long Beach, and am happy now to be here at UCI. First and foremost, I would like to take a couple of minutes, actually, to thank and acknowledge a number of people who have had key roles in making possible the endowed chair in this afternoon's celebration and installation. And I hope I don't leave anyone out. It is actually a great joy to have so many individuals to thank. I think it is an indication of the collaboration that has marked the Armenian Studies program at UCI and will continue to mark it in the future. So first and foremost, I remain immensely grateful to Drs. Vahe and Armine Meghrouni and the Meghrouni family. I can always pretend the applause vote was for me. whose commitment to the study of the Armenian past, foresight, and generosity have made possible the endowed chair in Armenian Studies here at UCI. A special thanks to Sylvie Terzagyan, the advisory committee, Alison Arapkayan, and so many other members of the Orange County Armenian community for their determination and support to establish an endowed chair in Armenian Studies. To the members of the search committee for hiring me, and to Raj Dayai for his extraordinary effort and commitment of precious time and energy on behalf of UCI Armenian Studies before I arrived. Thanks also to Dean George Van Den Abbey and the School of Humanities for recognizing the significance of an Armenian Studies program and facilitating the establishment of an endowed chair. To Associate Dean Andrei Morminsky for his determined efforts during the process of appointment. To Nicole Balsamo and Mariana Lekusis for their critical role as intermediaries between UCI and the Armenian community, and for making my road to UCI much smoother. Last and by no means last, the special thanks to David Igler, Chair of the Department of History, whose advocacy and attentiveness during the hiring and appointment process contributed both to smoothing the path and lessening my anxiety. this is obviously a special day for UCI Armenian Studies, but also for me professionally and personally. So if you don't mind, I will take a few minutes as I will get a little personal here, okay? So at the risk of embarrassing my mother, today is her birthday. And it brings me immeasurable pleasure to share this moment with her, Sireli Mamas, with my incomparable sister and confidant, Sanam. My nephew, Christoph, who makes us always proud, and has his biggest sponsor to me. And of course, my partner in life, Sehu Aslanyan. It has so often been said that it's going to sound like a cliche, but I'm going to take that risk and unequivocally state that there is absolutely no doubt in my mind that I would not be standing here before you today were it not for their unwavering support, unconditional love, and their much appreciated and often perfectly timed sense of humor. They have my profound admiration, gratitude, love, and respect. Sehu in particular is a fountain of intellectual stimulation and inspiration, a trusted critical reader of my work, whose honesty, integrity, good heart, and brilliant mind remind me that I made the right choice. And on a good day, the one whose enveloping and loving embrace both soothes and gives flight to my spirit and my mind. On a good day. My only regret is that the two people who would have also savored this moment, my maternal grandmother and my father, did not live long enough to see it. My Greek grandmother, my Yaya, would have been proud of this moment and this university setting perhaps more so because although she spoke several languages, she was illiterate. My father, for whom education was paramount and yet out of reach, and Armenian history of particular interest, would have been uncharacteristically emotionally moved. Their absence, however, is dwarfed by the presence and the blessing of a loving and devoted family, as well as a group of much cherished and loyal friends, most of whom I'm happy to say could be here today. My welcome task today is to share with you my vision of Armenian studies, not only here at UCI, but also of the field itself. As a preface though, there are lots of prefaces, I feel obliged to do what I always ask my students to do when embarking on serious study or inquiry, that is to reflect and take stock of themselves. I ask them to keep in mind Italian theorist Antonio Gramsci's notes on the study of philosophy. He writes, I quote, "The starting point of critical elaboration is the consciousness of what one really is, and is knowing thyself as a product of the historical process to date, which has deposited in you an infinity of traces without leaving an inventory. So such an inventory must therefore be made at the outset," end quote. Therefore, it is an inventory and a disclosure of sorts, I promise not sordid, that I offer you in order to make sense of my approach to Armenian history and my vision of the field of Armenian studies and Armenian studies at UCI in particular and in that order. My inventory begins even before my birth in Beirut. Like most of the Armenian diaspora, I am a descendant of the survivors of the Armenian genocide. I grew up with certain ideas of my own history as an Armenian who was born not in Anatolia and the Armenian plateau, my grandparents' homeland, but in Lebanon, a place I was taught was a welcome refuge, which had provided a home to so many refugees fleeing for their lives as it continues to do so today, but was nevertheless sadly not my homeland, that I was to some degree a guest, born there because of a tragedy that had befallen my people, a crime forgotten by most of the world and denied by many of the descendants, although not all, of the perpetrators. And it is in this way that I was socially conditioned and poisoned to yes, to some degree, with anger, paranoia, and victimhood, a conditioning that intensified in my teens growing up in Southern California, having fled the civil war in Lebanon. The Turkish-Armenian journalist Hrant Dink, murdered in 2007 by a young Turkish ultra-nationalist, once noted, I quote, "Armenians, especially of the diaspora, tend to have a problem associated with the role of the other that the Turk has played in forming the Armenian identity. There is a certain history, a trauma. The Turk has become such a source of pain that it poisons the Armenian blood, as the Anatolian saying goes," end quote. For Dink, a quote again, "There are two ways of getting rid of this poison. One way is for the Turks to empathize with you and take action to reduce your trauma. The second way is for you to rid yourself of it yourself," end quote. My personal journey from my nationalist teens to my humanist 20s and beyond, I won't say how far beyond, thanks in large part to my years at UC Berkeley, has been a rewarding and worthwhile journey to rid myself of that poison and to devote my energies into the uncovering of the Armenian past in productive, scholarly, and transnational rather than national or nationalist ways. In the process of healing this collective trauma within myself, I have found along the way friendships with Turks who do empathize and do take action to reduce the trauma as they proposed. My interest in the history of Armenians, not surprisingly, to a certain extent, is very much informed by the impact of the collective memory of genocide. Just as my approach to it, though, that is global and interconnected, is driven by my family's multicultural past, as well as by the long history of the dispersion of Armenians, their history as trans-imperial and transnational polyglot subjects traversing geographic as well as cultural, religious, ideological, and other boundaries, and oftentimes straddling multiple identities. As such, they are ideal subjects for interactive, global, historical approaches. In my research and writing, I have sought to use Armenians and Armenian language sources to tell a bigger story and to employ the regional and global context to understand the Armenian experience and rich past before genocide. I would like to bring an example from my recent project, in a little more detail perhaps than Taraj, to help make a case for global analysis to Armenian history, a fairly new approach that has increasingly grown in importance and number of practitioners, including most notably my partner and himself a holder of the UCLA Armenian History Chair, Sebu. My current book employs roving Armenian revolutionaries, weapons, print, and global ideologies such as constitutionalism and socialism, as a vehicle to give a broader account of early 20th century revolutionary connections through a connected histories approach. At the same time, it engages with the larger world context of technological transformations in steamship, railways, and telegraph to make sense of their mobility. A connected histories approach that focuses on accelerated circulation during revolutionary movements at the turn of the 20th century allows us to grasp not just the similarities and parallel developments of the Russian, Ottoman, and Iranian revolutions taking place between 1905 and 1911, but also the ways in which they were linked to each other and the globe and the wider world. Sometimes scholars studying in hindsight do not see eye to eye with contemporary observers or historical actors. In this case, though, the connectedness of revolutions is not merely the imagining or interpretive powers of the scholar, but of the actors themselves who repeatedly, through words and deeds, linked revolutionary aims, processes, and outcomes, and viewed them beyond their local and regional regional significance. So if they did it, so can we. They were not, however, oblivious to the complications, problems, and obstacles in the way of enduring success and achievement of their goals and vision, but they fought on despite them and collaborated with fellow comrades of all backgrounds, sometimes even against their own and others' cynicism and grave misgivings. They did so because they believed that too much was at stake if they did not take the reins over their intertwined futures, theirs and those of their neighbors. Viewing our subjects within a global context has the benefit of expanding our local and regional lens to appreciate more fully the global transformations affecting revolutionary fervor, dissemination of print, and appropriation of ideologies, and the journeys of our revolutionaries, while simultaneously bringing our historical actors, the Armenians, from the margins into the center. In other words, such an approach inserts Armenians into global history and global historical studies. It also invites global historical studies to rethink the place of the less well-represented and little-studied peoples like the Armenians. In a sense, therefore, a retelling of revolutionary history through the lens of roving Armenian revolutionaries brings Armenians out of the marginality they have at times inscribed for themselves and others have inscribed for them, to tell a much more compelling and intriguing story that spans empires and provides a way to foreground histories often hidden by national and nationalist approaches. Therefore, it pursues a transnational, or in this case, trans-imperial perspective that allows us to view the shared histories of peoples, including the Armenians, who had far more in common with neighboring peoples than nationalist interpretations have recognized. In his assessment of Ottoman Armenian history, for example, Girard Libaridian writes, I quote, "The problem, simply phrased, is that historians and others who have tried to tell the story of Turkish-Armenian relations toward the end of the 19th century and early 20th centuries have been unable to imagine a common history, one that accounts for the complexities each found in its situation and areas where common thought and action evolved." End quote. I believe the same applies to Russian-Armenian and Iranian-Armenian relations at the turn of the 20th century or any other hyphenated Armenian experience. The post-genocidal national and nationalist narrative by Armenian and other scholars has edged out almost all other perceptions and treatments of the Armenian role in history in general, and their own revolutionary movement in particular, and certainly in regional struggles with global dimensions. Whenever I have presented my work on early 20th century Armenian revolutionaries participating on multiple fronts in three revolutions, I have been asked at least one question. It's a good thing you don't have a chance to ask that question. I have been asked at least one question about why these Armenian revolutionaries did not see the genocide coming, and how could they pour their limited resources, numbers, and energy into revolutions that did not live up to their potential, and one that actually led to genocide. I propose we look at this differently. Historical actors, like the Armenian revolutionaries, whose legacies I have attempted to bring to life in my work, are to some extent, despite their agency, always enveloped in fog. Here I am borrowing Czech novelist Milan Kundera's characterization. In his description of Russian novelist and thinker Leo Tolstoy's conception of history, which minimizes the role of individual will, Kundera writes, I quote, "Knowing neither the meaning nor the future course of history, knowing not even the objective meaning of their own actions, they proceed through their lives as one proceeds in the fog. I say fog, not darkness. In the darkness, we see nothing. We are blind. We are defenseless. We are not free. In the fog, we are free, but it is the freedom of a person in fog. He sees 50 yards ahead of him. He can clearly make out the features of his interlocutor, can take pleasure in the beauty of the trees that line the path, and can even observe what is happening close by and react. Man proceeds in the fog. But when he looks back to judge people of the past, he sees no fog on their path. From his present, which is their faraway future, their path looks perfectly clear to him, good visibility all the way. Looking back, he sees the path, he sees the people proceeding, he sees their mistakes, but not the fog," end quote. And so our revolutionaries could only see a few steps ahead, but we look back and see a clear path into the past. We ask, why did they not see the genocide around the corner or any of the other relatively smaller disappointments and barriers on that foggy and yet promising revolutionary path full of potential? Could it be that the fog was just too thick? Or could it be merely that there were no discernible or indisputable portents or signs that we, in hindsight, erect with such certitude? With the advantage of hindsight, with far more sources at our disposal and a global lens that sees more deeply and at the same time more widely, we look back onto opaque and misty pathways in an attempt not to offer a sharp and tidy past, but to shine light on the past full of nuances and complications, promise and disillusion. We must do so without forgetting the fog that enveloped our historical actors as they struggled and envisioned a brighter future near and far. Now, looking through the fog myself to assess the present and future place of Armenian studies at UCI, I believe the Meghrouni Endowment has given us a solid foundation on which to build. UCI Armenian Studies has tremendous potential to promote appreciation for the histories and cultures of Armenians and Armenia by teaching and mentoring undergraduates and graduate students and helping to prepare new generations of specialists in the field who will be able to contribute to its scholarship in novel and significant ways. I foresee UCI Armenian Studies developing into a strong and excellent program in healthy competition with counterparts at UCLA and USC represented here. I told you I'd point you out. In short time, perhaps, it could even surpass them. As the premier academic institution and scholarly program in which to pursue Armenian studies as an undergraduate or graduate student. Yes. Are we going home together? with that goal in mind, I promise to work toward further developing the chair in a few concrete ways. First, I will endeavor to build on the firm footing established by the Meghrounis, and to do so not only by expanding the Armenian program's financial resources, but no doubt equally important, by providing the vision and programming that would engage the Orange County Armenian community, you, and help you see that you indeed have a vested interest in the future of the program at UCI. These efforts would enable the growth of Armenian studies to include faculty and courses in other disciplines in the School of Humanities and other schools, especially the essential instruction of Armenian language, Eastern and Western. The much needed enlargement of currently meager, and I mean meager, library holdings, and the creation of a minor first and perhaps a major in the future. I would also like to earmark funds toward creating postdoctoral, predoctoral, and visiting scholar fellowships in Armenian studies, and providing undergraduate and graduate awards, scholarships, and research support. Cindy, you asked for, what was it? Wish list or fantasy list, we'll see which one. Second, I promise to devote considerable effort to attracting undergraduate and graduate students of all backgrounds to UCI's Armenian Studies program. Armenian history and Armenian studies are serious fields of scholarly inquiry like any other, and not merely within the purview of students or scholars with an Armenian heritage. Therefore, I will work toward making that facet more explicit and find ways in which to draw more students of all backgrounds into the program and the wider field. The training that students will receive at UCI must be one that emphasizes the study of Armenians and Armenia within a regional, that is Middle East and Caucasus, as well as world context, thus reflecting the global and interactive nature of Armenian history itself. At its core will be the exploration of Armenians as imperial and national subjects in ancestral lands, and also as trans-imperial and transnational subjects in a vast worldwide diaspora that has a complex and multifaceted relationship with the concept and reality of the homeland. This global approach to teaching and research training will not only be the most fitting way to study Armenians, but also the most pragmatic approach to producing graduates with the promise and potential for employment. They must find jobs at the end. We must ensure that we train undergraduate and graduate students and scholars who can think, teach, research, and write broadly beyond the confines of national history. Third, if you are Armenian yourself, or know Armenians, and if you don't, this is the perfect opportunity. Just turn to your left or to your right. You know that one of the things that Armenians lament is the lack of cohesion and unity among themselves, while the rest of the world looks on and sees them as tightly knit and a unified whole. In pursuit of the lofty goal of unity, at least in the realm of Armenian studies, I will work toward the collaboration of Armenian studies programs, starting with California and expanding into the rest of North America and beyond. This networking may be accomplished, for example, by creating a research and teaching postdoctoral program to be shared at first by UCI and UCLA, and then it can go further. That would benefit not only students and the programs themselves, but also the postdocs, who would gain valuable experience and be able to take advantage of each program's and campuses' strengths and collections. I would also like to initiate consistent and regular dialogue among chairs about the current state and future trajectory and prospects of Armenian studies, with the goal of developing or improving the state of the field, the experience of students, and relations between Armenian communities and the Republic of Armenia. Finally, I believe the Armenian Studies program could and should make a notable contribution to furthering and implementing the agreement recently reached between UCI and the American University in Armenia to foster the relationship between the two universities through collaborative projects, as well as student and faculty exchange via study, research, and teaching abroad. These interactions and exchanges will also no doubt strengthen the growing Armenian Studies program at UCI. To conclude, I am thrilled beyond your imagination to bring over 18 years of experience of teaching and administration, as well as an active research agenda to the UCI Meghrouni Family Presidential Chair in Armenian Studies and to the Department of History. And following the lead of the revolutionary subjects I study, I will work toward collaboration across fields, programs, departments, and schools at UCI and beyond. Thank you for your attention.
At this special occasion to celebrate the installment of Dr. Houri Berberian as the Meghrouni Family Presidential Chair in Armenian Studies. Since 1990, Orange County Armenian Professional Society is driven to provide social, cultural, educational, and philanthropic opportunities for its members. Over the years, OCAP's philanthropic mission has been to support the education of children and schools in Armenia and also in Orange County. Since 2009, OCAPS has donated over $36,000 to UCI Armenian Studies. Today, I'm pleased to present our last commitment contribution of $5,000 to Houri Berberian to help her in a small way to accomplish his visions.
Thank you, and as you know, part of the mission we have at UCI as a public university is to create a venue for stimulating inspirational dialogue with the public. One of those ways we do that is also through the Vahe and Armine Meghrouni lecture series in Armenian Studies, a public lecture series designed specifically for the community. We bring speakers from around the Europa campus at least five times per year to enlighten us with their knowledge of Armenian culture and history. And I invite you to consult the list of upcoming events, which I believe has been distributed, and hope that you will join us at one or more of those occasions. So
So please thank me again in joining our guests and faculty, our new chair, for their engaging remarks. Thank you for attending, and I'd like to invite you now to join us for a celebratory reception right outside here with good food, wine, and excellent company. Thank you all. Thank you.